morning and welcome to worship. It is good for us to be together. Welcome to those of you in our sanctuary space and those of you who are worshiping with us online. Welcome. I want to thank Sally Haas for playing piano for our sermon hymn today. She's covering for Lynn Peterson, who cannot be with us because she is in quarantine. So we thank Sally for playing. And for Lynn, we think of you as you continue to hopefully stay healthy. So we think of you today. Well, did you receive your newsletter? In your newsletter was a plethora of information, including how it is you can come worship with us on Easter. So on Easter Sunday, we will have a 6:30 a.m. worship service on the farm property. And then we'll have two services here in our building, one at 9 o'clock and one at 10:30. If you would like to come to worship and be in person, we ask that you please make a reservation for that. So that is part of the requirement of having in-person worship, is then a reservation on Easter Sunday. Our worship space can accommodate 60 people. To make a reservation, please call or email the church office, and once you make your reservation, you cannot change it. So thank you so very much for registering to come to make a reservation for our Easter service. We will celebrate, my friends. We will celebrate together. The 10:30 service will be live streamed. Again, welcome to worship. It is good for us to gather, to pray, to sing. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose voice is upon the waters, whose mercy is poured out upon all people, whose goodness cascades over all creation. Let us pause and confess our sin. We think of the ways in which we have not loved ourselves, our friends, the neighbor, and the stranger this past week, and we bring those sins and we place them at the feet of Christ. Through the power and promise of Christ Jesus, our sins are washed away, and you are claimed as God's own. Amen. We continue now with today's scripture readings.
Our first reading comes to us through Genesis chapter 17, verses 1 through 7 and 15 to 16. When Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to Abram and said to him, "I am God Almighty. Walk before me and be blameless. And I will make my covenant between me and you, and will make you exceedingly numerous." Then Abram fell on his face, and God said to him, "As for me, this is my covenant with you. You shall be the ancestor of a multitude of nations. No longer shall your name be Abram, but your name shall be Abraham, for I have made you the ancestor of a multitude of nations. I will make you exceedingly fruitful, and I will make nations of you, and kings shall come from you. I will throughout their generations for an everlasting covenant to be God to you and to your offspring after you." God said to Abraham, "As for Sarai, your wife, you shall not call her Sarai, but Sarah shall be her name. I will bless her, and moreover, I will give you a son by her. I will bless her, and she shall give rise to nations. Kings of people shall come from her." The word of the Lord. Our second reading is Romans chapter 4, 13 to 25. For the promise that he would inherit the world did not come to Abraham or to his descendants through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. If it is the adherents of the law who are to be the heirs, faith is null and the promise is void. For the law brings wrath, but where there is no law, neither is there violation. For this reason, it depends on faith, in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his descendants, not only to the adherents of the law, but also to those who share the faith of Abraham, for he is the father of all of us, as it is written, "I have made you the father of many nations." In the presence of the God in whom he believed, who gives life the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist, hoping against hope, he believed that he would become the father of many nations according to what was said, "So numerous shall your descendants be." He did not weaken in faith when he considered his own body, which was already as good as dead, for he was about 100 years old, or when he considered the barrenness of Sarah's womb. No distress made him waver concerning the promise of God, but he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God, being fully convinced that God was able to do what he had promised. Therefore his faith was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now the words "it was reckoned to him" were written not for his sake alone, but for ours also. It will be reckoned to us who believe in him who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead, who has handed over to death for our trespasses and was raised for our justification. The word of the Lord.
Thank you for reading this morning. We continue with our gospel, the gospel according to Mark, the 8th chapter. Then he began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering, be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days again, rise. He said all this quite openly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. And turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you're setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If any of you want to become my followers, let them deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Those who are ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." The gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. I feel bad for Peter. Or maybe it's just that I find Peter relatable. Or maybe it's both. At the transfiguration on the mountaintop, Peter had been so excited to see Jesus with Moses and Elijah that he wanted to build those dwellings and stay up there forever and ever. But Jesus did not stay on the mountain because there was work to be done. Today in our gospel, Jesus is teaching, and what he is teaching is not comforting. Jesus teaches that he will suffer and die. Poor Peter. Just a time back, he had such an awesome biblical encounter with his biblical heroes, Moses and Elijah and Jesus. And now in this public setting, Jesus is telling everyone who's listening that he is going to suffer and be killed. Now, if Peter's making some connections, then Peter, a follower of Jesus, is thinking to himself, if Jesus is going to suffer and die, what does this mean for him? Peter's so upset by what he hears Jesus saying, that Jesus will suffer and die, that he doesn't hear the last part about what Jesus is saying, that Jesus tells him 3 days later something amazing will happen. And all this is coming together in Peter's mind. The only thing Peter can think to tell Jesus is, shut up. Peter pulls Jesus aside and tells him to be quiet. To which Jesus responds to Peter, "You don't get it. Your mind is small. Your thoughts are little. This is not the way." There is more work for Christ to do, and he tells Peter to move over. I think sometimes in our lives we find ourselves with that voice of Peter floating in our heads, that one that tells us there has to be an easier way. You don't need to suffer. And it's really comfortable in that moment to hear that voice, to believe that for ourselves. You don't have to suffer. There has to be an easier way. But that's not true to life. And it's not what we believe. We believe in the suffering of the cross. We are part of a larger body that claims that through Jesus' life, death, and resurrection, we are given the gift of the forgiveness of sins and the hope of life eternal. And in order for us to fully receive that gift, we too die. During our confirmation service, there's this amazing thing that we do. We call the person forward, and they kneel down at the altar railing. And coming forth with them then is
family who loves them, who walks with them in life, stands behind the confirmant and lays hands on them. The pastor puts their hands on the heads of the confirmant, and then the pastor says this prayer, "Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in him the gift of the Holy Spirit, confirm her faith, guide her life, empower him in serving, give him patience in suffering, and bring him to everlasting life. Amen." No one wants to suffer, and yet suffering, fear, and doubt are part of our lives. What do we send confirmation students out into the world with? A promise that God walks with them, will not abandon them, does not forsake them, that the light of Christ dwells there forever and ever and ever. The devil wants us to believe that we can handle anything on our own, that we don't need anybody else. We can do it ourselves. It is one of the ultimate tricks the devil plays on all of humanity, that all you need is you. And that's a lie. What we need is our Lord and Savior. And finally, after we've tried over and over and over to do it ourselves, we finally fall on our knees and say, "Lord, I can't do this anymore alone." And this is when God holds us and says, "Child, I know." Forgives us and gives us courage then to stand back up and to move forward in our life, promising us, reminding us that we are claimed by God. We are not alone. I have a prayer for you this morning, my dear church, and it is a blessing. Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in your church the gift of the Holy Spirit. Confirm our faith, guide our lives, empower us in serving, give us patience in suffering, and bring us to everlasting life. And all God's people said, Amen. We continue now with the blessing of music, and we will hear the hymn sung this morning, In the Cross of Christ. So we thank our musicians, we thank our singers for being with us and blessing us with the gift of song. Much for your gift of song. We continue with our prayers of intercession,
And we think of those members of our congregation and our communities who continue to recover from COVID. The number one saying from members of the church is that as they recover from COVID, they feel tired, that it is hard to breathe. And so we think of those folks in our very communities, and maybe it is you yourself this day who continues to recover from COVID. So we think of all of you. We pray. We pray in our everyday lives and our call to follow Christ and to share the good news. May we have courage, Lord, in our prayer and in the belief you hear them. We pray for all the people of the world, those suffering, those who do not know safety, those who do not have homes to live in, those who are hungry, for those who are lost. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all medical staff caring for those living with COVID, for those recovering from fatigue and difficulty breathing, for those who are waiting to receive vaccinations, and for those who are administering them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our students and teachers and staff. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our nation and all of our leaders. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those we ask God's blessing on, and we name them out loud now. Who would you like to pray for? Wherever you are in your home, say them out loud. We pray them with you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For all these prayers and those we hold in the silence of our hearts, we ask God to hear us and help us. Amen. Well, my friends, it is time for us to have communion. And so for those of you at home, you will need your bread, your cracker, your water, wine, or grape juice. I know for you Wisconsinites, a chicken and a biscuit, it's your favorite to use for communion. Does everybody have their communion ready? Please hold your bread. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to the disciples, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Please hold your water, your wine, or your grape juice. Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Let us pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please now take your bread and hold it in your hand, and I say to you, the body of Christ given for you. Amen. Please now hold your water, your wine, or your grape juice. I say to you, the blood of Christ shed for you. Amen. Christ Jesus, at his table we have feasted on your very life, and we are strengthened for our journey. Send us forth from this banquet, nourished in body and in spirit, to proclaim your good news and serve others in Jesus' name. Amen. God the Creator, strengthen you. Jesus the Beloved, fill you. And the Holy Spirit, keep you in peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Go in peace, my friends. Be the light of Christ. Amen.